to episode 50 of Life and Life Only. And for the half century, got something special here. This is more of a personal podcast episode, but hopefully you'll get something out of it. I did originally have a special guest lined up for episode 50, but he will be held over till episode 51. I'll tell you who that is at the end of this podcast. But I'm actually on location today. I'm in a little town of Egham in Surrey, which is a county about an hour or so from London. Egham probably won't mean too much to people unless they're from that area. And in fact, on some of the guest podcasts I've done, sometimes they'd ask me where I was from, and I'd say I'm from a town called Egham that's so nondescript that some of the people that live there have never heard of it. But I don't mean to talk down Egham, because it's got a special place in my heart, basically because I grew up here for the first 8 or 9 years of my life. Also, today is Wednesday, August the 14th, and today is my 49th birthday. Keep that to yourself, listeners. I'm a little bit self-conscious about it, but thought I'd tell you anyway. And yes, it's the 50th show in just over 3.5 years, and it's a little trip down memory lane for me. I'd also like to talk about nostalgia in general, which ain't what it used to be, apparently. That's quite a famous quote. I tried to find out where that originated from, but got a few different answers. But I'm actually sitting here on the same road as my old school, and I'm just looking over at the school field now. I found a quiet spot. I've just opened the window a little bit because I thought it might be nice to occasionally hear a car going past. As long as it's not too loud, I might pause as they're going past, but anyway. So I lived in Egham from 1976, when I was a baby. Anyone alive at that time remember 1976 was a very, very hot summer. Not that I remember that, of course. And I lived there until 1983, when I was 8 years old, in fact. I'm saying that Egham is quite nondescript. It does have a few claims to fame. It's got one of the campi, of Royal Holloway College, which is quite a famous university in England. Also, just next to Egham is a place called Runnymede, which is technically classed as a water meadow, whatever that is. A stretch of water, really. That's all it is, really. But, yeah, incredibly, the Magna Carta, probably the most famous document, most important document, arguably, in English history, was signed at Runnymede in 1215. 9 years ago, they had the 800th anniversary of the signing of that. There's also a couple of other things. There's a World War II Air Forces memorial in this area. There's also a memorial to John F. Kennedy. Why it's in Egham, I've never actually managed to ascertain. But Jackie Onassis, formerly Jackie Kennedy, apparently did come to Egham in 1964 when this memorial was created and was put up. Also, there was a film called The Wrong Box from the late 60s, which had in it Michael Caine, Peter Cook and Dudley Moore, and Peter Sellers, included scenes shot at Englefield Green. And Englefield Green is actually where I am. My school is in that little village. It hasn't changed too much. Egham's changed a little bit. Obviously, you can't stop progress. It's going to happen anyway. Bill Hicks did a gig in Egham, amazingly. One of my, probably my favourite stand-up comedian ever, actually, and a bit of a guru to me. That was on YouTube. If it's still there, I'll put it in the show notes, but I don't think he has any Egham material in his set. He might comment on it. I don't think I've actually ever listened to that, but I've listened to a great many other sets of his, kind of a comedy rock star almost. Sadly died in the early 90s, and he was in his early 30s. So I split my childhood in a way into two phases, which is the Egham phase and then the phase in Maidenhead, which is a town in Berkshire that we moved to. When I grew up in Egham, I had family close by. I was writing about this last year for the book that I was writing, and I call them the Benevolent Triumvirate, which is a reference. The Triumvirate is a reference to the Roman Empire, in fact, when Caesar was killed. Three people shared power. That was called the Triumvirate. Anyway, so that was my granddad, Jeff, my grandma, Mary, and my grandma's brother, my great-uncle Ted, who sadly lost his wife to cancer, in fact, just a few months after I was born, 76. About 10 years ago or so, I had a dream where I was with my granddad on a bus, and the funny thing was that in the dream I knew it was, whatever it was, 2013, 14. But my granddad looked exactly the way he looked when I was a child. So obviously younger and healthier than he did towards the end of his life. And I had a dream that we went round Egham on a bus. And at the end of the dream, he got off the bus and he said, oh, you know, this is my stop, which obviously can be a bit symbolic with trains and buses. You know, I'm getting off at this station. And in the dream, he disappeared. And then I was actually here 3 years ago, I think it was. I come here every few years. It kind of centres me a little bit. I quite enjoy coming here, although I will talk about the downsides of coming back to your hometown a bit later on. When I was here last time, I took the train from London. I kind of had a day trip, London and Egham. And I had this funny, almost like a waking dream. Not that I believed it happened, but I had this funny idea that wouldn't it be strange if I arrived at the station and my granddad was here at the station, you know, and he'd come down from the clouds, from heaven, and we could walk around Egham and he could check in on my life and, you know, how's it been since I left? He died in 2000. And I could fill him in on my life and maybe he could give me a couple of bits of advice for the future. And then he'd go and I'd get back on my train. I thought that was quite a nice image, just checking in before leaving again. Now, I've always felt that I was shaped by those first 8 years, as many people are, of course, but I feel like my soul, if you like, is in Egham, you know, and I have such sharp memories when I come back here. And even when I'm not here, you know, I just sometimes in that funny time when you're going to sleep or you've just woken up or whatever. Also, when I meditate and I clear the space, images come up from my childhood, and it always tends to be Egham because I was much happier here than when we moved. So I think of parks. We used to go to Windsor Great Park. I think of even the church, because this school opposite where I am now, it was a Catholic school. And I've had a complicated relationship with religion or religious faith, but it's always been there, you know, and obviously the spiritual side of religion has appealed to me, and I took up meditation. I've always been interested in spirituality anyway, so that was born here. And I was just walking around the town just before I drove up to this village, to my school. And, I think the purest version of me was definitely shaped here, you know, having family around, a community, that kind of thing. And that definitely something got lost. I'll go on to that in a little bit. I didn't want to tell you a little story, quite a funny story. I was a strange kid, which you'll probably find very hard to believe. And I used to be a very fast runner. And in my street, Linwood Avenue in Egham, I think there was a party for the Silver Jubilee of Queen Elizabeth. It was 1977, which I would have been definitely too young to remember. But I do remember there was a street party for the marriage of Prince Charles, now King Charles, and Princess Diana, which was in the summer of 81. So that was around the time when I was about five going on six. And in that second street party, they had a running race. And I was winning the race. And then when I got to the finish line, I stopped at the finish line. Now, I think a psychiatrist, psychologist would have a field day with that, trying to work out what that's all about. Some fear of winning, guilt about being faster than everyone else, God knows. But then it happened again. Probably must have been around the same time. On this very field that I'm looking at now, the same thing happened. I was, you know, in school sports day, I was winning the race. And then for some reason, just stopped at the finish line. I think they did award me the race. I can't remember. I don't think a street party running race is a high stakes event. So they probably just said, oh, well, we'll let him win and give him a milkshake or something. Yeah, that was funny. And in fact, in around 2011, I came back here to Egham and I went to Linwood Avenue and I met one of my old neighbours, a woman called Mrs. Gadd, who had lived there when we lived there and was still living there then. And I told her about the street party and she said, oh yeah, I remember that. And she said that when Queen Elizabeth had her 50th anniversary, the Golden Jubilee, 2002, she tried to get some sort of street party going, but people weren't generally interested. And even though one of my neighbours did tell me that there is still a community spirit in Egham, obviously everywhere there has been a loss of community spirit. You know, we've all become much more individualistic, and society is all about what you can get for yourself. So we've lost a bit of that, but that was quite a good gauge of it, because we still have photos somewhere in the family vault of, I think, both those parties. As I don't remember the 1977 one, but from the pictures, it looks like it was a real magic occasion. On that visit in 2011, I went past my old house and there was a gentleman gardening in the front garden. And I said, oh, how long have you lived here? And he said, since the early 80s. And I said, oh, I think you bought the house from us. And amazingly, I kind of talked myself into the house almost. Just for a couple of minutes. He said, oh, you know, I was telling him all about, oh, my room was here. And I'll tell you a bit about my room in a second, in fact. And the garden and everything. And he said, oh, do you want to have a quick look inside? And I said, oh, yeah, okay. And it was funny, actually, because I think his wife had died a few years earlier and he kind of let the house go to ruin a little bit. So weirdly enough, when I went up those stairs and I saw my little room, my little bedroom and the house in general, it looked like nobody had lived there since we left, you know, as if it had been left derelict, which made it even more strange, a little bit eerie, in fact. But yeah, that was nice. Now, in my family, when we moved, there was a little bit of a split in that my dad and both my sisters basically couldn't wait to leave Egham. They didn't have any strong connection with it at all. I'm not sure exactly how my mum felt about it. I, at the time, wasn't too sad to leave because I didn't know how I was going to get on at my new place. It was, in fact, December the 16th, 1983. I had my last morning at St. Cuthbert's School, which is the school where I'm at here. And I was sad to leave in the sense that I remember just that morning being really nice and enjoying being with my friends. I was pretty popular. I was a leader of a little gang in Egham or at St. Cuthbert's. And in a minute, I'll talk about another person who liked being leader of a little gang. We'll get onto that. For football fans of a certain age, that day, December the 16th, that evening, Friday evening, was actually the first ever live televised league match in England. Man United beat Spurs 4-2. For those who are interested. On YouTube, I don't know if you've ever done this, but if you look up, if you're English, for example, BBC or ITV continuity, and then you put the date in, some people who are, I don't know who they are, but they've posted what they call by continuity is it'll be the end of a programme and then there'll be the news or whatever, and then it'll be some adverts from that time. It's basically a TV broadcast. So I've actually looked at a couple of... Oh, car's going past. I've actually looked at a couple of videos of continuity from that day. Not that I can really remember that evening, but yeah, that was a new chapter, the start of a new life. Only 30 minutes down the road, yeah, half an hour's drive. But I noticed quite quickly that our neighbours were just a little bit more standoffish. And it's interesting, isn't it? Because basically the reason we moved was that my dad got a better job in his career. And I think that's why him and my sisters naturally, you know, most people would always be happier going to a bigger house in a better area, let's say. But obviously the higher you go up the social ladder, the further away the houses are, the more private people are. And I noticed that straight away. Though we did come back to Egham quite regularly because my grandparents lived there until... 2005 was when my grandmother died. My granddaughter died in 2000. And Uncle Ted died at the beginning of 2002. So it was a good 20 years or so that we were going back to the house. And whenever we went to see my grandparents, who lived quite near us, for anyone from Egham who happens to be listening, they lived on Grange Road. And on the way back from visiting them, we'd always say to my dad, oh, can we go? Can we see Linwood Avenue? Like I said, I've been back a few times over the years. Never quite sure if it's a good thing to do or whether it's almost literally a backwards step, you know, going backwards in time. I just remembered one other thing, because I was talking about Egham earlier and its claims to fame. This is something quite bizarre. For those who know my story a little bit, you'll know that I had a band in Madrid and we had a Cuban drummer called Ernesto, who was a real character, and he really did a great job of colouring my songs with a little bit of a Latin feel and a jazzy feel at times. When I first met him in Madrid, he said, where are you from? And I naturally always say London as a vague reference point, you know. And he said, oh, whereabouts? And I said, well, actually, I come from a small town. There's no way you'll ever have heard of it. And he said, oh, what was that? And I said, Egham. And he said, oh, I used to live there. And I thought, what? How is that possible? But turned out his wife, who's English, went to Holloway College. So I suppose it's not that strange, but I do remember thinking that if you believe in fate, I probably think this is the right drummer for me because he happens to live in to have lived in Egham. That was quite strange. But going back to when we moved, quite often a house move or some sort of relocation can affect a child quite badly. And I've seen this a few times, and I don't know if any of you listening to this have had this or you know people have had this. It's really a case of luck, you know, obviously the family grew up in and the area we live in, and it's not necessarily about socioeconomic status. Obviously a poor area will tend to have higher crime, that's a statistical fact. But that doesn't mean that the people there are any worse than people that live in good areas. I mean, I'm not talking about criminals, but just normal people living there. Rich areas, very rich areas, are quite often very soulless, and the people are property mad, which I suppose is natural because they've got more to defend, and standoffish, which is the word I used earlier. And Maidenhead in Berkshire, where we moved, it wasn't posh, but it was middle class as opposed to lower middle class, which is how I'd class Egham, which is my natural standing. I always say if I won the lottery, I'd buy a Vauxhall Astra and a comfortable house, probably not that big a house. I mean, I've never personally been into status symbols and expensive items. And we can reference back to the series I did on Darren Brown's book, Happy, at the end of last year. I can't remember which part because it was four parts, but there was one I was referencing something in the book where Darren said, why do we need to buy things such as clothes? They don't make us happy. Jewellery, you know, big diamond ring or whatever it is. And I think Darren was actually quoting someone else from, I don't know if it was a book or something, but someone had said, if you were the last person left on Earth, imagine in a fantasy, everyone died except you, but everything worked. So, like, imagine living in society, but just on your own, literally the only person. Why would you live in a big house? There'd be absolutely no reason to live in a big house, and there'd be absolutely no reason to wear a diamond ring unless you happened to think it felt comfortable on your hands. Why would you have a big house if you're the only person left on Earth? There'd be no reason, really. So why do we have big houses and diamond rings and expensive stuff? Obviously, it might be related to attracting a partner, but let's say you've already got a partner. Why would you do it? The only possible reason, then, surely, is to impress other people. But anyway, just to say that, I learned a bit of a lesson because we moved up the social ladder, but I was far less happy. Soon after we moved, I started school, January 1984. The scene switches from St. Cuthbert's School in Englefield Green to Oldfield School in Maidenhead, and a very different atmosphere. I went from, as I said, leader of this little gang of mine to someone who was ostracised for the terrible crime of joining halfway through the school year, and I retreated into my shell, which was made worse about a year after that by needing glasses. And of course, anyone knows who has become short-sighted, more and more short-sighted to the point they need glasses. As a kid, that day when you first appear with glasses is just horrendous because gradually everyone in the class will see you wearing glasses. And I remember that very clearly, just dreading the point where all of my friends would see and everyone else in the class would see me wearing glasses. It's just a couple of bits of plastic stuck to my nose. It's nothing more. It's so ridiculous that it's such a big deal. But it did mean that I became more and more shy. And I became a bit chaotic as well. And very, very lost, you know, into my teenage years. I eventually got contact lenses, talking of sight. But when I went out, I started drinking. Used to drink fairly heavily in my teenage years. And I'd often sleep in my contact lenses. And I'd wake up the next day and say, it's a miracle, I can see. And then I'd realise I'd slept in my lenses and my eyes would sting like anything. I didn't used to clean the lenses properly. I lost my way pretty badly. And I don't know if I found my way back, to be perfectly honest. I'm not sure about that at all. I mean, I used to think when I was young that at 35 or 40, you know, the pain went away and life got easy and comfortable. But I realised that the challenges keep coming. And then if you think of a career, when you finally retire, whatever the retirement age is now, maybe some people retire early, and then you've got to deal with old age. So, you know, the challenges never go away. You know, there's an old joke, isn't there, that when you're young, you've got time and energy, but no money. When you're middle-aged, you've got money and energy, but no time. And when you're old, you've got time and money, but no energy. And the joke is that that's a bit of an exaggeration, but there is a little bit of truth to that. I was just going to briefly talk about someone who was leader of a little gang who I mentioned earlier, which is, of course, John Lennon. Now, for those who are new to this podcast or haven't heard of me before, I have three podcasts, as well as this one. The most high profile is called Glass Onion on John Lennon. It's obviously about John Lennon, and sometimes about the Beatles in general. And then I have another podcast called Film Gold, obviously about films. Some of you will know my history with John Lennon. And just going back to my house in Linwood Avenue, one of the first things I noticed when I became a Lennon fan, I saw a picture of his house, which is Mendip's, which is now owned by the National Trust. And he had a little room just above the front door, which is exactly what I had. I was also quite a dreamy boy, which I realised John Lennon was. Short-sighted, as I've mentioned, John Lennon refused to wear his glasses and would shinny up lampposts to see street signs to work out where the hell he was. I wrote something for this book that I was working on and may still happen, and I called it The Blind Goalscorer, because when I was in the Cub Scouts, as it's called in America, I was a very good centre-forward for football, i.e. soccer. I went a whole season and scored about 25 goals, but I didn't wear my glasses, so I didn't really know much about what was going on. I could only see what was directly in front of me. And not to spoil the whole story, but there's a bit at the end where I talk about we decided to tape my glasses to my head with a bit of elastic just to see how I'd get on, and I was absolute rubbish when I could see. But that thing I wrote, The Blind Goalscorer, that's probably the best thing I've ever written, because it was a true story with a few embellishments. I just wrote it straight off in an hour or so. But from about 14, I discovered John Lennon through the Ray Coleman biography of Lennon, the Imagined film from 1988, and to some extent, John and Yoko, A Love Story, which is quite a cheesy TV film with Mark McGann as John Lennon. He was a very good John Lennon. And I kind of discovered the Beatles at that time as well. They were almost parallel, my Lennon and Beatles fandom. Whenever I go to Liverpool, it's another place I find myself going to quite a lot. I feel like I grew up there. It's almost like it's my childhood. That's how strong this association is. And again, is that healthy? I don't know. Someone once told me, maybe the Beatles are ruining your life, because the Beatles story in itself is so freakish and such a magical story in many ways. I know some parts of it have been disputed. There's one guy who disputes all of it, basically. The whole thing is a hoax. But taking the official version of it, you've got that, the miracle of how the Beatles happened, plus John Lennon's sense of magic and sense that the normal world is boring. I definitely got a bit of that, and I don't think that's very healthy. You know, George Martin, the Beatles producer, said something along those lines, that Don just couldn't handle normal life. You know, he needed action all the time and something amazing or magical to happen. So I don't know, maybe he did help ruin my life. I'm not sure about that. When I was doing one of the early Glass Onion episodes, I started that podcast in 2019. I think it was 2020. It was around the height of the COVID thing. I did a discussion with a guy called Robert Rosen, who'd read John Lennon's diaries. And I said to him, do you think John had any special knowledge? And he said to me, I don't know what special knowledge he would have had. He didn't quite know what I meant. And I said, and I realised I was being a bit naive, you know, even though I was already in my 40s when I started the podcast. It's this idea that John Lennon was special in the sense of not being just a normal human being. And arguably that's true of him and Jimi Hendrix and Bob Dylan or whoever. But I don't know what special knowledge I was looking for with that. The other quite humorous aspect of that is I mentioned earlier the house Mendip's where he grew up. Now, some of you will know the National Trust bought, or Yoko Ono actually bought it, donated to the National Trust. There's a Beatles lyric, Lennon lyric.
Lying with his eyes while his hands are busy working overtime. A soap impression of his wife, which he ate and donated to the National Trust.
The National Trust, own Mendips and 24 Flynn Road, which is where Paul McCartney grew up as a teenager. And I've done that tour, which is an absolutely amazing tour. I've done it probably six times, I want to say, in the last 20 years. And in a nutshell, that they managed to restore the houses to look almost exactly as they looked when they lived there. And obviously some of the fixtures are the same anyway. But I was just doing a podcast for Glass Onion, and the person that was on it, we were talking about that tour, and he said, oh yeah, when I went on that tour, I stopped in John Lennon's bedroom after everyone had gone just to soak up the atmosphere, because that was the centre of John Lennon's life, as with many people, you know, the teenage bedroom. And that was where, you know, him and Paul would have listened to Elvis records and Elvis Presley records and Chuck Berry and Little Richard and whoever it is, and learn those. You know, that's major in music history, let alone just Beatles history. And the funny thing was that that's what I've done a couple of times when I've been there. You know, I wait till everyone goes. I even meditated in that room, or certainly, you know, shut my eyes and had a peaceful moment. But the first time I did it, you know, I still had this kind of naivety of thinking, come on, John, give me a lyric. You know that you and I have got this special bond. And that, you know, it was almost to the point of, oh, I'm the only one, you know your spirit's living on through me. Come on, mate, give me something. And not surprisingly, nothing came particularly. Although, you know, being in that house was very, very interesting. That's why I've done that tour so many times, and Paul's house as well. One thing I can tell you is that recording this now is very therapeutic. I'm enjoying this a lot. And thanks to everyone for being part of this audience that allows me and motivates me to keep doing this quite niche podcast. We're just reaching 50,000 views on the 50th episode, which is quite appropriate. That doesn't include the YouTube stats, and they're quite good actually. In fact, one of the I think the emotional intelligence podcast I did, part one of it, has had something crazy like 50,000 views. Obviously part one tends to be, when you do a multi-parter, it tends to have higher figures than the other parts. But anyway, I think I have a nice little audience here, and I appreciate you all. I never take it for granted. Another aspect of going back to a place where you haven't been for a long time, or you spent time a long time ago, is that obviously things like, I don't know, lampposts and gates and things like that are often original, and street signs and so forth. And on this road, in fact, called Corby Drive, where this school is, I actually turned round in the car, did a three-point turn, the same spot where my mother used to when she picked us up from school. In Linwood Avenue, where I just was earlier, there are still lampposts where we used to have running races, and they were the finish lines, probably for that street party I mentioned earlier. And those lampposts and so forth have been there all that time while the world has been going on, and I've gone through all my changes and progressions and regressions. And at the school here, I can see the fences still have posts separating each bit of fence. We used to use those as goalposts for football matches in our lunch break. I used to be football mad as a kid. Got a little bit back into it with Euro 24 that just passed, but I've been pretty much off football for about 15 or so years. I tend to watch tennis and boxing sometimes, a bit of snooker and a bit of athletics. But in the town centre in Egham, I don't think there's any shops which are original to the 80s, but there are couple of fixtures there. There were some steps going up to another level where the baker's was. I remember there were actually two bakers in the town, but my granddad, who I had a very close relationship with when I was a child, a lot of that was based on football, but, and based on you know, sweets and things like that. But he used to walk me, when I went to visit, he used to walk me into the town. And I was saying earlier about how I was shaped by Egham. I like the small town idea of going to the baker, then going to the butcher, and then there wasn't even a cinema, but there was one nearby in a place called Staines. Any Ali G fans, that's where he came from. And I remember going to watch E.T. That would have been 1982, possibly 83 in England, because they used to come out about 6 months before they did in America if they were Hollywood films. Memories are sharp, but I do want to talk a little bit about memories. Are they real? Are anyone's memories real? And is childhood glorified? Now, if you're enjoying this episode and you are any kind of Lennon fan, you might want to look back at Glass Onion on John Lennon episode 98, which came out just before Christmas last year, called John Lennon and Me. And it had a somewhat similar flavour to what I'm recording today. though obviously a bit more about John Lennon in that case. But yeah, memory's real. I mean, we all know now that memories are fallible, and an eyewitness testimony to crimes or whatever it is might be very fallible as well. Some people will swear, I saw a red car. Another person will say, no, the car was blue. Another person will say, no, the car was definitely green. And they're not lying, it's just that memories are unreliable. And they're, you know, I have a few memories that I'm pretty sure are accurate. And I think this community feeling that I was talking about earlier was real. I mean, we could literally leave our back door open. It was a happy medium in a way, because you could leave your back door open, but you had no chance of it, you know, someone coming into the house and nicking something from your house. I just remember talking to a friend who'd grown up in a really rough area of London, and I said that about back door open. He said, yeah, we tried that as well, but the fifth time we got robbed, we started locking it. But there really was that community feeling. But beyond that, I don't know how many of these memories are real. That community feeling is probably something I've been chasing ever since. And it's made me quite depressed at times. That's why I was saying earlier, is this a good idea to do this? Or is it a bit painful? But those memories are also quite golden, and they can be a lifeline at times. So I think I'm going to leave you here with the question, is nostalgia good or bad? Is it a good idea to revisit places from your past? Does it matter whether it's a good past or a bad past? Because it might be, if you had a bad past somewhere, it might be useful to go back and try and wipe that slate clean. In the same way that primal therapy, which John Lennon and Yoko Ono did, was about reliving traumatic childhood memories and trying to change that. I don't know. I read the book The Primal Scream, but I don't remember exactly. Alan Parry, who I know listened to this podcast, hi Alan, who I just met recently in Liverpool and was on Glass Onion once, he discovered something called memory reconsolidation therapy, which might be worth looking at. For any of you who do have traumatic past or traumatic events from your past that you feel are holding you back. Anyway, send me your thoughts or leave comments on the YouTube videos if that's where you listen. Couple of things before I go. I am a life coach. If you'd be interested in life coaching, or you know anyone that might be, please write to me, lifeandlifeonlypod@gmail.com. And that's a place to write for feedback as well. Everything's in the show notes. Please rate and review and share links. I'm not chasing hundreds of thousands of subscribers for this podcast. I don't generally compromise with it. You know, I could do all kinds of marketing and get more likes and possibly more listeners, but I would just ask if you wouldn't mind just taking a moment to, as I said, rate and review and just tell others if you like this stuff. So the next episode, which was going to be episode 50, I'm going to be having a discussion. I don't want to call it an interview, I want to call it a discussion with Matt Le Tissier, who Southampton fans will certainly have heard of. He was quite a famous footballer in the 90s and then was a pundit for a while. Now, a few years ago, Matt got himself into a little bit of social media hot water, let's call it, when he spoke out against the COVID vaccine. He made it clear he wasn't anti-vax, because that's a very, very general term, but he was questioning this particular vaccine. So that episode that's coming up, I'm going to be meeting Matt, not in the flesh, unfortunately, but on Skype, I imagine, next week. Matt and I are going to be delving deep into football and the psychology of sport. Probably won't harp on the COVID thing necessarily. I'm sure it'll get mentioned, but I do like to help promote my friends. And Matt, a couple of years ago now, was on The Mind Renewed. Regular listeners to Life and Life Only will know all about The Mind Renewed and Julian Charles. So I'll put a link to Matt's appearance on that podcast. Anyway, I will see you soon for episode 51 with Matt Le Tissier. I hope you enjoyed this. I know that another person's childhood and memories will never have the same importance that your own one does, but it's nice for me to think that some of you have expressed an interest in some of my stories and the particular journey I've been on. I guess that's the beauty of doing podcasts and having an audience. And of course, I'm a voracious podcast consumer as well, so I have that relationship from the other side with shows I like. With all that being said, see you soon. I'm going to leave you with a little something. I have mentioned this on the Lennon podcast, but one of the records I used to listen to when I was a kid, with my granddad and grandma was a record called Cocktails and Piano. We actually discovered it somewhere in the basement of one of our houses a few years ago. And amazing thing about it was that even though I thought I hadn't been much of a Beatles fan until I was about 13 or 14, I discovered years later, listening back to this record for the first time in about 30 years, that there was a cocktail jazz version of Yesterday on it. And I used to dance to this record with my granddad when I was a very, very small child. So I was, in fact, some kind of Beatles fan, even from a child. That was a great discovery. I likened it, I think, at the time to finding out years later that George Harrison's mother used to listen to an Indian music channel in Liverpool when George was in the womb, and also when George was a little child. And George Harrison, as a lot of you will know, became a fan of Indian music and everything that goes with it, Indian culture, Hindu religion. I think he discovered it, quote-unquote, in his 20s, and it was a lifelong thing for him. So what I'm going to do, this is side A of Cocktails and Piano. You're going to hear some popular songs, Chanson d'Amour, Strangers in the Night. I don't know the name of the third song, because on this record, they all had different names. He'd given them all strange names. Not the very well-known ones, but a couple of the other ones. The fourth one is probably my favourite, is a melody from the composer Borodin, which became Stranger in Paradise. And then you've got the aforementioned cocktail jazz version of Yesterday. And then you've got Love Me Tender, obviously made famous by Elvis Presley. So if you'd like to listen on, why not sit back, get yourself some kind of drink, whether it be tea, water, or something stronger, and listen to 15 minutes of very relaxing cocktail jazz. And until the next episode, take care of yourselves in this crazy world. All the best from me and from Egham in Surrey. Goodbye. Thank you.
Thank you. fantastic, and I hope you enjoyed it. There is a point. Is there a point to all this? Let's find a point. Is there a point to my act? I would say there is. I have to. The world is like a ride at an amusement park, and when you choose to go on it, you think it's real, because that's how powerful our minds are. And the ride goes up and down and round. It has thrills and chills, and it's very brightly colored, and it's very loud, and it's fun for a while. Some people have been on the ride for a long time, and they begin to question, is this real, or is this just a ride? And other people have remembered, and they come back to us, and they say, hey, don't worry, don't be afraid, ever, because this is just a ride, and we kill those people. Shut him up. We have a lot invested in this ride. Shut him up. Look at my furrows of worry. Look at my big bank account and my family. This has to be real. It's just a ride. But we always kill those good guys who try and tell us that. You ever notice that? And let the demons run amok. But it doesn't matter, because it's just a ride. And we can change it anytime we want. It's only a choice. No effort, no work, no job, no savings of money. A choice right now between fear and love. The eyes of fear want you to put bigger locks on your door, buy guns, close yourself off. The eyes of love instead see all of us as one. Here's what we can do to change the world right now to a better ride. Take all that money we spend on weapons and defense each year and instead spend it feeding, clothing, and educating the poor of the world, which it would many times over, not one human being excluded, and we can explore space together, both inner and outer, forever in peace. Thank you very much. You've been great. I hope you enjoyed it. You're fantastic. Thank you. Thank you very much.